A speck of greatness. I take that playful image from the repertoire of the Honorable Louise Bennett, our finest cultural icon in terms of preserving our language heritage. Miss Lou, as she's affectionately known, is really our premier poet of the people. And I take my title from one of her very important poems called Independence. Yes, dance. She's looking at the song and dance of independence, and she's playing with the way in which Jamaicans use language. For the benefit of our international audience that doesn't know Jamaican very well, but I must hasten to say that there are many people across the globe that are completely competent in Jamaican. There are many Japanese, for example, who don't know English, but they know Jamaican. And many times in the debates we have in Jamaica about language, we keep saying, oh, but Jamaica is just a sort of limited language and nobody else knows it and we must only know English. I say, English is a global language which we must all celebrate, but that doesn't mean that we must disregard our own mother tongue. I tell people that Jamaican is my mother tongue, English is my stepmother tongue. And so I start with an English translation of a line, a verse from Independence. She hopes they've warned the map makers to stop drawing Jamaica so small, because that little speck can't show our greatness at all. And you will hear the difference in the body language when I give you the original Jamaican. Show up then cash and world map. Fi stop draw Jamaica small. For the little speck can't show we independentness at all. And then this is Miss Matty, a persona that Miss Lou has created. Miss Matty continues, moreover, we must tell the map makers that we don't like our position. Would they be kind enough to take us out of the sea and relocate us in the ocean? Our rightful position, more so ever, we must tell map that we don't like we position. Please kindly take we out at sea and draw we in the ocean. Now, you may laugh and say, what an ignorant woman. How can you relocate people across the globe? And obviously, at a certain level, that's humorous. But really, what Miss Matty is acknowledging is the fact that cartography is not a very precise science. If you know the history of map making, you know that maps continually change as we get more knowledge about how land is distributed, but also it has to do with geopolitics. You know, you get wars and people own property that suddenly they lose and you have to keep redefining the boundaries of what belongs to whom. Furthermore, Miss Matty's vivid image of repositioning us out of the sea and putting us in the ocean is an acknowledgement of the transatlantic origins of the Jamaican people, particularly the African-Jamaican group that she's talking about. But our history is a history of migration. We have Europeans, Chinese, Indians. All of us have a sense of ancestral homelands. And so this idea of repositioning Jamaica, taking us out of the limits of the Caribbean Sea and putting us in the ocean, is therefore a recognition of what I call an island people with a continental consciousness. So that's my first explanation for why this little speck of Jamaica is so great, because we don't limit our conception of ourselves to our present location. We envision a landscape of greatness that we're an essential part of. The Third World Band, Reggae Ambassador, is one of their classic hits. And you can dance.
So everywhere I jump, it's the same question. How can a big music come from a little island? When the music plays, it leaves them in a state of shock. The big, big music from the little rock. Oh, 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 yay. I'm Mr. Reggae Ambassador. Hey. Oh, 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 yay. I'm Mr. Reggae Ambassador.
So everywhere I jam, it's the same question. How can a big music come from a little island? When the music plays, it leaves them in a state of shock. The big, big music from the little rock. So I use reggae as a metaphor for the little music that comes from, you know, a small place but has globalized the world. And we see this not just in the field of music, but I tell you, in the 1990s, I was on a fellowship at the University of the South Pacific doing research on Caribbean and Pacific women writers. And I couldn't believe it. There in Fiji, Fijian reggae. I was in the Pacific, I said, I want to go to Papua New Guinea, because Papua New Guinea is Africa in the Pacific. When you look at the art, when you look at, you know, the way the people represent themselves, you see that these people came ancestrally from Africa. I got myself to Papua New Guinea. I got to the university. I just called the vice chancellor. I'm here from Jamaica. He said, you are? Can you come and speak at the university? I said, yes. I had a wonderful time. And I heard Papua New Guinea reggae. And this now wasn't just Bob Marley or Peter Tosh that people were playing. They had indigenized the music. It was their own music. On my way to Fiji, I stopped in Hawaii. I spoke at the University of Hawaii. And again, Jawayan. That's a new music that the Hawaiians have created out of the fusion of Jamaican music and Hawaiian music. So this global dispersal of the music suggests something to me about the greatness of Jamaican people. In 2008, at the University of the West Indies, we hosted a conference on global reggae. And we had speakers from every continent coming to talk about the impact of reggae in their part of the world. So music, but it's a metaphor. Look at sports. I don't have to tell you about the successes of our athletes. We're having today champs, and champs is about athletic skill. It's about the body, but it's also about the mind. If you haven't conditioned your mind, you can't be a great athlete. Did I miss one? No. Yes, religion. The emergence of Rastafari. In the 20th century, Jamaicans create a whole new religion. And it's not only Jamaicans who believe in the religion, you know. They managed to get people all over the world to say them turn Rasta. We translate that. Jamaicans have created in the 20th century a new religion. And it's not only Jamaicans who believe in this religion. We have people all over the globe. Black, white, Chinese, Indian, claiming Rastafari. It's amazing. How could Jamaicans create a whole new religion? Yes, it has its origins in the Bible, but Jamaicans have simply taken those biblical concepts and transformed them. The children of Israel in the wilderness are black people under slavery. And we have also, in that process of reclaiming a sense of identity, recognized that our history in the Americas didn't start with slavery. We know that Africans were here before Columbus. As Burning Spear says in his famous song, Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus is a damn blasted liar. And he says, whole heap of mix up, a lot of stuff that is mixed up. Whole heap of ben up, a lot of distortions have to be straightened out. And so we have reggae music, we have sports, we have religion, we have language. The Jamaican people have created language out of the various dialects of English that we were forced to learn and the various African languages that we brought in our heads. When we came, nobody said, pack your stuff, you know, you can take your cultural artifacts with you. But they couldn't take out what was in our heads. And so we were able to use our creativity to develop new languages. Now, because of the class and racial politics of our society, that language has been devalued. And so we have a school system that is trying to teach children in English when they come into the classroom only knowing Jamaican. And I give you a good example. A primary elementary school teacher told me she saw a little boy running in the schoolyard, and she said to him, whose class are you in? The child looked at her with complete mystification and said, E, miss. And she immediately told him, don't say E, because E is one of those nasals in the Jamaican language. She repeated the question, whose class are you in? The child repeated his response, E, miss. Finally, she got sensible and said, who are your teacher? Who is your teacher? The child immediately gave him his teacher's name. Now, somebody who hears this interaction would say, oh, imagine this child doesn't know his teacher. He certainly knows his teacher. He doesn't know English. And so this is one of the problems that we have to battle with in our society, recognizing the value of the Jamaican language. Literature is one of the other areas in which you have excelled in the society globally. The Calabash International Literary Festival has been a phenomenal success. Unfortunately, it has ended, but we need to acknowledge what it means that as a small society, we were able to create a global festival that attracted people, artists, writers from across the globe who came to celebrate with us. Pulse Entertainment Group, I speak a little bit as an insider. The CEO is my brother, Kingsley Cooper, but it doesn't matter. He's a visionary who recognized that fashion was something that as Jamaicans we affirm, and he was able to create a whole industry out of modeling, out of fashion, and Caribbean Fashion Week has been a very important initiative. I will make a little style now and tell you that this outfit that I'm wearing was made by our premier diva designer, Lainey. She's retired now, so this is not really marketing. She's retired, Elaine Witter, and she made it for me 1 year for Fashion Week. She says, you need to go and show those young people what we old women can do, you know? And I said to her, the only difference between you and those big time European designers is the fabrics, the style you have it, you know? And I've always tried to give her fabrics like this one from Ghana that excite her imagination. So fashion is one of the areas in which a small island can have a global impact. I remember going to a conference in the UK. The third morning I came out with one of Lainey's designs, this woman came to me and she said, you know, I'm Italian, but I have to tell you, your clothes are beautiful. I said, yes, Jamaican designer, with great pride. So next area is science. I have 5 minutes and I'm moving along quickly. Science, I want to let you know about Dr. Marcia Roy, R-O-Y-E. She is a Jamaican scientist, a biotechnologist. Oh, there was a little bit more on her. It seems to have last dropped out of the PowerPoint. But she has just got a major L'Oreal Award for science. The first person from Jamaica, and the first year this award is being given in honor of Madame Curie, who was such an important female scientist, the first woman to get the Nobel Prize. And here we have a young woman at the University of the West Indies winning this prize in science. Global Jamaica, I think I'm going to come back to her. International Affairs, the case of Marcus Garvey, the founder of the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League, an advocate of Pan-Africanism. And I describe Marcus Garvey as a style icon, you know. Quite apart from the ideology, Marcus Garvey loved to dress up. So yes, here's Dr. Roy, received the L'Oreal UNESCO Special Fellowship Grant to mark the centennial of Marie Curie's, award, Nobel Prize in Chemistry. And her research is in the area of plant virology. And she has been doing research in plant virology and antiretroviral drug resistance in HIV patients, Jamaica. Here's a Calabash Literary logo, the winged heart. Such a beautiful image of potential and creativity. And finally, just to say that among the 100 writers attending this festival over the last 10 years were two Nobel laureates, Derek Walcott, St. Lucia, Wole Soyinka of Nigeria, some of the Jamaican authors, Linton Kwesi Johnson, Olive Senior, Erna Broadbent, Edward Ball, and Colin Chano, the Jamaican in the diaspora who conceived this festival. Now we have some successors, the Ashanti Adonai Literary Line, which will be held in Winefield, St. Anne in May, Talking Trees Literary Fiesta in St. Elizabeth, and the Jamaica Poetry Festival in Kingston. And just an image of Caribbean Fashion Week, where we see the movement, people on stage, the excitement of a small idea going global, where designers from across the globe come to Jamaica to celebrate their own creativity, but also ours. And I end just with that image, the globe encircled in that triangle pulse, Jamaica beats. Suggestion that however small we are, there is an energy that vibrates in Jamaica. It's the energy of creativity. And my big idea is that I want us as Jamaicans to recognize the power of our culture. Because so often we demean the culture, we demean the language, we demean the body language of the dance hall. I've been invited to the Eastern Caribbean to give a talk at the open campus of the university. And the woman who invites me in St. Lucia says, Carolyn, we've been following all of the discussions about Vibes Cartel and popular music. She says, I want you to give a talk to the high school students. I want you to talk about popular culture. Please put Vibes Cartel's name in the title, because I know it will attract the students. And in Jamaica, we get instead cartoons that represent Vibes Cartel as a vampire, because at home, we don't fully understand yet the power of Jamaican popular culture. So I end with the idea that we are, in fact, the affirmers, the articulators of spectacular greatness. Thank you.